The China Banking and Insurance Regulatory Commission has vowed to support Hong Kong's financial institutions amidst a deepening standoff with the U.S. For some perspective, Brock Silvers, chief investment officer of a Hong Kong-based investment fund, now joins us live from Hong Kong. Hi, Brock.
Hey, good morning. Great to be back.
Great to have you. So over the weekend, Beijing's banking regulator gave assurances that Hong Kong's financial market is generally operating smoothly. The dollar peg is solid, reflecting confidence of the global market in Hong Kong, and its status as an international financial center will not be weakened or shaken, but will be more prosperous and stable in the future. Brock, does it feel like it on the ground?
Well, look, we have to understand sort of what's been happening here. You know, Hong Kong for a long time has been an international finance center, but the model for Hong Kong is changing. You know, the future now seems to be more as a center for Chinese outbound finance, as Chinese companies that need access either to Western markets or really, what you know, Western hard currency, maintain a focus there. Hong Kong had been the West's window into China, and going forward, it's looking more and more like China's window to the West. And I think what Beijing is saying here is they are pledging to support that transition.
So, net effect, is this good or bad?
Well, it's both good and bad. I mean, it certainly is interesting. Hong Kong will evolve, and that is a matter of perspective as to whether or not we like that. Will it be good for Hong Kong? Well, I think the model will evolve, and if the new model continues to work, Hong Kong will be pleased.
Now, between China's national security law, pretty controversial there, and the crackdown in Hong Kong, and the U.S. ending preferential trade treatment for Hong Kong, it's like caught between a rock and a hard place. I can only imagine how multinational companies, including global banking institutions, must be feeling right now, walking so close to the edge.
Yeah, look, it's a very tricky situation and environment right now for multinationals and financial institutions in Hong Kong, where clearly everyone wants to maintain broad legal access to the world's two largest economies. However, it's still really an evolving matter. There are some businesses and business lines that will gravitate elsewhere, and Singapore looks like an early beneficiary. But time will tell, and what I do think is that whatever remains at the end looks like it will be both more Chinese and more China-focused.
You mentioned, Brock, about possibly some moving or gravitating towards other hubs like Singapore. What are you seeing so far? You know, we know that many have long set up a plan B when this happens, but on the ground, is money actually leaving Hong Kong? I mean, are the rich, are the investors fleeing the Hong Kong investment scene in case the situation gets too hot?
There has been significant high net worth outflows from Hong Kong, and again, Singapore has been a beneficiary. But that's also been a longer term, more subtle process. You know, none of the changes we're seeing now were wholly surprising to the market. So people have had time to prepare their plan Bs and sometimes plan Cs. So we will see some high net worth outflows. We have, that should continue. Corporate outflows as well have been happening, but that's a longer term process and will require more time. What I think is also a real threat to both the China and Hong Kong economies, though, is supply chain relocation, which is real and is occurring, but again, is a longer term event. So we'll have to see how that plays out over time. But what we do know is that none of this is good news for Hong Kong, and it's coming at a time when Hong Kong really doesn't need any more non-positive news.
I wanted to look at the ties between China and Hong Kong. We know that the legislative elections in September have been delayed for a whole year. We're not seeing any major shakeup in the political environment. But if you look at the finance side, how intertwined Hong Kong and China is, the links are pretty tight. I read somewhere data that Chinese companies have raised, what, over $100 billion in IPOs in Hong Kong since 2015, the likes of Tencent and CNOOC. Hong Kong is actually the most popular destination for Chinese overseas investments, and China's state-run banks are keeping at least, what, $1 trillion of assets in Hong Kong, their biggest offshore market. Do you think, can this, you know, China and Hong Kong, can China's tighter grip on Hong Kong work for the better in the end?
Well, the ties are certainly tight and tightening, that's for sure. What we have seen is that now that, as I've said, the role for Hong Kong is sort of changing to China's window to the West, they are using that as a conduit for international hard currency fundraising, market expansion, et cetera. The end result will be that Hong Kong will be, I think, more thoroughly integrated into the mainland, and that might be a benefit for everyone. However, here's the risk. If the U.S.-China relationship goes further southward to the point where the U.S. challenges or undermines the Hong Kong dollar peg, that could remove the very reason for the new model for Hong Kong that Hong Kong seems to be exploiting in a positive way. And if that happens over time, then Hong Kong could find itself less relevant, certainly than a Shanghai, but perhaps even than a Shenzhen.
Oh, wow, we're all walking on eggshells here, Brock.
Well, look, that's a negative possible future outcome. Mm-hmm. It's not really what we're seeing today. As you said, the dollar peg seems to be robust right now. Mm-hmm. So I'm not sure that that's an immediate fear, but that is the risk. If the dollar peg goes away, then the new model for Hong Kong would no longer work.
Okay, a final question, Brock. There's another big market mover expected this week, the speech of Fed Chair Jerome Powell at the annual Jackson Hole Economic Symposium. Our side of the world, Asia, gets to react on Friday, but what do we want to hear?
Well, Powell certainly is the world's main market mover. the markets want to hear U.S. stimulus plans. Exports from Hong Kong and China to the U.S. have long been a fundamental pillar for those economies. And a strong U.S. economy is needed in order to stimulate the demand for those exports. Mm-hmm. However, I really think we need to revisit that whole dynamic. It's a new world, and I'm not sure that those export flows will ever return to what they had been. So I'm just not certain that U.S. demand will be the key that pulls Hong Kong and China back from their downturns. Mm-hmm. If that's the case, what we hear tonight in Asia, if we hear U.S. stimulus plans, I think the markets may positively overreact, which will create some risk or opportunity depending on your market positioning. And if we don't hear sufficient stimulus plans, then I think markets here are going to have to start to confront a new reality, and that may be a lengthy and less pleasant process.
Okay. On that note, Brock, always a pleasure speaking with you. Thank you for joining us.
My pleasure.